What also gave Kerry a great sense of satisfaction was his association with the men working under him on many of the construction projects. Having had first-hand experience, he knew a lot of the work was hard and physical. Kerry respected their men for their efforts, and this respect was returned and in many cases turned into firm friendships. Paul Tapra, one of his shift bosses, is one such person. Paul, like Kerry, is retired and lives around the corner in Turangi. They still get together, and often on these occasions, the conversation slips back to the construction days.
Once the invert slabs were poured, Paul and his gang here came along and they did the slip form of the sides. And on a cold winter's morning, they managed to do one a day, and that was the first slip they ever made. But they very rapidly learned what the routine was, and eventually they got up to 7 slips a day, which was very good progress indeed. Paul, now, how did you manage to get up to 7 a day?
We learned a system that made it easier for us, but also it was faster. And so we got to the stage where we did 7 slip forms a day, which was a good record.
Oh yeah, very good. That was a very good record.
And everybody was quite happy with that.
Paul, when you get up to 7 slips a day, what motivated you to do the 7? Why didn't you just do 3 or 4 and be done with it?
Because of the engineer who couldn't believe that we had done 5 in a day. And he said to me, he says, do 7 and I'll shut you. I says, you're on. And within a short period of time, take 2 weeks, I went up to him and I said to him, hey, we've done 7 bays. No, you haven't. I said, go and have a look. So he did. And he says, okay, wash out. And he shouted the whole gang, which was fantastic.
Paul, why is it that so many of us have decided to retire in Turangi? In fact, a lot of people have come back to Turangi to retire.
The bond that was set when we worked together, not only on our particular job, but overall with the Ministry of Works, everybody bonded together during our working times and also in our leisure times. Especially the women folk felt the bondship was here in Turangi. And I'm speaking for Māoris and Pākehās as well.
In 1971, Kerry Scott was promoted to Project Construction Engineer. This made him number 2 in the project management hierarchy. He moved into the management offices in Turangi, to what was affectionately known as Bullshit Castle. Kerry became a little more desk-bound, but it was hard for him to resist an almost daily field trip to keep an eye on progress. In the early 1970s, both the Tukanal Tunnel and Power Station were nearing completion. During this construction period, Kerry would develop a strong working relationship with a young civil engineer, Gary Gay, who was sent to Turangi from the design office in Wellington. Gary the boss, and Gary the new boy on the block, perhaps because of their civil engineering backgrounds, hit it off and worked well together.
Gary, that was the penstock track, and getting the actual strakes of penstocks into position was your first problem that you came on when you came to Tukanu. I can't remember all the details, but there was all sorts of switches and things. Can you tell me what the hell did you do?
Yes, I was working in the power design office in Wellington back in 1966, I was offered a job here at Tukanu. And I jumped at that, of course, because I'd been designing some of these structures, and now was an opportunity for me to get in there and be part of the construction of them. So I came up to Turangi, and I remember coming down here to Tikanu, and the boss at the time, he got out some sort of layout drawings. He said, "Righto, here's the penstocks. You sort out a way of getting those penstocks down the hill." So here I am, a 27-year-old, straight out of an office, and I get this very daunting task. Over a period of 2 or 3 months, I put forward a proposal to make up the penstocks into as large as sections as we could in Turangi, because obviously you didn't want to be doing difficult work on the penstock slope if you could avoid it. So bigger chunks as we could get, and we transported them down from Turangi to Tikanu here on a road that was specially built, because the weights were such that we couldn't put these things on the main highway. And then we took them up to the top of the slope, and we had a couple of trolleys under each section, and we slowly railed them down using a winch and a cable into their final position, and then we put them on steel legs and sat them there.
When you were lowering them down, did you have any moments of sheer terror or excitement?
We sure did. The very first section we brought down, I was standing downstream of the section, and the section came over anchor block 2, which is the one immediately above the powerhouse, and as it came over the anchor block, I could see a gas bottle had been left inside the penstock and it hadn't been tied down properly. And as it came over onto the steeper grade, this gas bottle started to slide out, and me and the chap that were with me, we both ducked down. The gas bottle went flying over the top of us, went end over end down into the powerhouse, and as it did, the nozzle broke off the top and it was flying around like a balloon.
Gary, I remember coming down here and looking at the excavation, which was immediately downstream of the powerhouse now. The scoopers were working in clouds of steam. It was pretty warm down here. And then down here somewhere, we got a geyser, didn't we?
We did.
And that...
That was one of our investigation holes.
We're doing
some investigations.
Okay.
And the rods came flying back up the hole, and we got
it. It was all under pressure. There weren't a reason why.
We had quite a nasty little accident there with that hot water. We had a chap, Alistair Gilby, who was a mechanical guy. Yeah. We had a pumping sump, you may recall, just tucked in by the powerhouse. And we were pumping very hot water. Alistair was down here doing some work on them one day, and he slipped. He had gumboots on, and he slipped into the hot water, and the hot water went into his gumboots, and they scalded his one of his legs rather badly.
The ministry works pushed ahead, dredging the tail race, installing the penstocks, and completing the Tokono Power Station. Kerry watched the progress with a sense of satisfaction, and shared the jubilation when on September 1st, 1972, Downer's Construction blasted the hole through of the Tokono Tunnel. Two of the four generators in the Tokono Power Station were commissioned in July of 1973. The nation was now receiving the first electric power from the Tongariro Power Development. This was indeed a proud milestone. Although there was a great sense of achievement with the commissioning of the Tokono Power Station, the drought of 1973 created some urgency for the government to push ahead with the final stage of the Tongariro Power Development. While work on the dams, tunnels, and canals of the Eastern Diversion were under construction, what was needed to generate more electricity was the approval of a power station at Rangipo. Rangipo was finally approved in November of 1973, but it was not until 1983 before the power station was opened. Rangipo was to be the second underground power station in New Zealand after Manapouri. It was designed and constructed by the Ministry of Works. Rangipo was the final stage of the project that the young Scottish civil engineer first investigated 15 years earlier. Kerry relished this new construction challenge. He was again to be teamed up with Gary Gay. Gary had proven his engineering capabilities at Tokono and was promoted to Rangipo resident engineer. The two settled into what would become a 10-year challenging and extremely rewarding project.
That's Rangipo North, that's in the powerhouse thing. They're putting in the...
This part of the development had aroused the anger of the Tongariro and Lake Taupo Anglers Club and forced the Wildlife Branch of Internal Affairs to assess the potential harm of reduced river flows on the trout fishery. This necessitated further environmental investigations.
Well, Rangipo, as I recall, was the first job in which we had to prepare an environmental impact report. This was something quite new. Thank God we didn't have the Resource Management Act then, but even so, there were quite stringent requirements placed on us because we were working within the Kaimana Forest Park, that we kept that construction footprint to the bare minimum. And I think we achieved that, but generally speaking, everything in the complex is underground. It was a very big excavation. In fact, we took 50,000 cubic metres of material out of this chamber. The method we used was drill and blast, which is a process whereby you drill holes into the rock, you load the rock with explosives, gelignite, your rock breaks up, and then that rock is loaded onto transportation and taken out of the tunnel. And in this way you develop your hole, you get it bigger and bigger. But I think the main challenge in building this particular chamber was the size of it. In the tunnels we used steel support, but because of the span in this large excavation, steel support was no longer an option, it was not strong enough, so we went to rock bolts, and that was something quite new. The access tunnel was the dimensions of it were partly set because of the size of some of the equipment that had to be brought in. But even then, there were a few squeezes. The powerhouse crane was quite a squeeze getting that in. The scroll cases, which are the snail-shaped spiral casings at the bottom of the machine, I recall that we had to actually tip them on their side so that they came down the access tunnel on a slope, just to squeeze those in. But yes, everything had to come in and out of that access tunnel.
That is the tail race tunnel, and that's Downer and Company doing the tunnel. They did the 3 kilometres.
Water?
Yeah, that's water coming pouring in. Yeah, we had water, but we also had soft ground in there. We're obviously having problems there because you can see that they've got these supports, and we must have been going ahead in a crown excavation and then a bench.
Downer had a problem in the middle of the tail race tunnel. There was a big fault in the country just underneath the Waikoko stream.
There was a lot of water in the tail race tunnel. In fact, it got to a stage where they couldn't advance the tunnel because of the amount of water coming in. And to get around that, they built a timber bulkhead up against the face of the tunnel, and then they injected grout in behind that bulkhead, attempting to drive the water away from the tunnel line. Now, they pumped grout for maybe a week or maybe even 2 weeks, a long, long time. And then they broke through the bulkhead, hoping that the tunnel would be nice and dry, and in fact, it wasn't.
For almost 15 years, tunneling crews dug into the dark unknown, pitting their skills against the harsh environment. The geological challenges at times were enormous. The variations in the rock structure, the heat of a live volcano, and water, the perpetual flow of water, were some of what at times must have seemed to be never-ending challenges. Despite the hardships, these men worked with pride and a competitive spirit against formidable odds and brought the task to completion. You were getting up to 25 years on this project. What were your feelings inside you looking at the project coming to fruition?
Well, I was pleased that what we'd started out to do 25 years ago, done all the survey and investigations, I had got my life's achievement that, you know, I had investigated this scheme. I was going to damn well build it. Well, not quite come hell or high water, but that was my feeling, and it was a great pleasure to see it come into fruition.
Your personal achievement of being involved in this huge project was extremely rewarding.
Yes, it was. I and the fact that we had such a good team, and I don't mean only the engineers, I mean the men that worked on the job. Let's face it, without the men, we'd have got nowhere. And it was often their expertise and ability to do things that counted. It was like the rest of the world. There was a dearth of power in New Zealand, and it was vital to the development of the country and to get the exports going. At the beginning of the 25 years, as you talk about, it was highly important because there were problems with getting power fast enough.
On the 18th of November, 1983, the underground power station at Rangipo was officially opened by the Prime Minister, the Right Honourable Robert Muldoon. Turning the switch on the power generating turbines at Rangipo was the conclusion of the Tongariro Power Development.
The project wouldn't have been built if it hadn't been for the men, and the project is a testimony to their skills and their industry. I really have to speak of my mother and father, because it was their sacrifice which pushed me through university and subsequently getting the positions I got. And it was thanks to them, really, that I'm here today. It's really been a life of full of fulfillments and targets reached and all that sort of engineering work, because that's what's driven me on, I guess, to achieve and be in the construction of the Tongariro Power Development, which was 25 years of Margaret's and I's lives together.
Kerry Scott was a young civil engineer when he first arrived in Turangi in 1957. From investigations engineer to project construction engineer, from its beginning to its end, the Tongariro Power Development was very much part of his life. Kerry Owen Scott was awarded the Queen's Service Medal for his services to soccer at Government House in April of 2008, a fitting tribute to a man who has been so much part of Turangi.